Doug, just as soon as you tell me, we're ready. And we are live. So welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming. We're so glad you've chosen to worship with us today. I have a few announcements to get us started. As always, it gives me great joy to tell you that First United Church of Christ and Conference Center is a church with full real-life standing in the Eastern Association, Southern California, Nevada Conference of the United Church of Christ. And anyone you see with a minister tag is an ordained UCC minister in real life. And there's two of us here this evening. As we like to say, it's good to be real in Second Life. And as a UCC church, we'd like you to know that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Our service will be in voice and text. Music will be on the media viewer, so be sure that you have media turned on. Please try not to touch the viewer. It just stops playing for everyone. There will be a link in nearby chat if you want to view the video in your own browser or you're having difficulties. If you would like a bulletin for today's service, you can find it in the red binder in the back. If there are any other announcements about the life of the church, please type them in nearby chat during our gathering music. Now, most churches have a time of offering. Making an offering, sharing what you can in God's name, is a spiritual practice. That offering can be an offering of prayer, of presence, an offering of work on behalf of the church, doing things like reading scripture and serving on the board of directors, hosting social events, being a guide, think usher in real life, leading Psalter, participating in church governance by being a voting member, or helping with any of the myriad of things that are needed for the church to function. And, or, because this is a real church, that offering can be money. As a UCC church, we support the work of the wider church, both with prayer and with donations, as do all UCC churches. And though we don't have a physical building, there are monetary costs for this ministry to function. So if you'd like to make an offering by participating in leading worship or social events, or if you would like to become a member of this church, let any clergy or staff member know. Doug would be particularly happy to sign you up for doing readings in worship. We will be accepting new members formally on Pentecost, May 31st. So let us know if you'd like to do that. If you would like to make a financial offering to support this ministry, there is a donation bowl by the door to the sanctuary. Or you can go to our website. There's the link, there's the URL, and you can make a donation in real life currency. We are a 501c3 public charity, so monetary donations are tax deductible in the U.S., and we thank you for the blessing of your presence and your support. We will be celebrating Holy Communion today, so if you haven't already, I invite you to collect the elements, some bread, a cracker, a cookie, something to drink, wine, juice, water, whatever you have. There's no right way or wrong way to do that here. And set them next to you wherever you are. You may also want to light a candle as we light our candles here in our sanctuary to remind us of God's presence with us. So now we light a light in the name of the God who creates life. We light a light in the name of Christ, who loves life. We light a light in the name of the Spirit that is the fire of life. Three candles, three lights, a trinity of love. God above us, God beside us, God within us. Amen.
Thank you. welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome. All are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome. All belong. Welcome all the brokenhearted, all who sorrow and despair. You are not alone, for you are God's own. Together we sing and we proclaim, all are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome, all are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome, all belong. Welcome all who suffer violence, all who long for safety and for peace. You are not alone, for you are God's own. Together we sing and we proclaim, all are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome, all are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome, all belong. Welcome all who are forgotten, excluded and dignity denied. You are not alone, for you are God's own. Together we sing and we proclaim, all are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome, all are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome, all belong. Welcome all who work for justice, bringing hope, charity and peace. You are not alone, for you are God's own. Together we sing and we proclaim, all are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome, all are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome, all belong. All are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome, all are welcome. Bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome. All belong.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite gathering songs. So I believe that worship is when we, as a community, join our hearts together to connect to God and to each other So this time of prayer, is the essence of what we do here together. So now, in silence or in words typed in nearby chat, let us give thanks for the gift of this day and pray for the life of the world. If you have a prayer of joy or concern that you wish to lift to God and have supported by the energy of those gathered here, type it in nearby chat at this time. As people share their prayers in text, please read them prayerfully and hold this space as sacred and safe to open our hearts to God. With Doug, we pray for Marie, Laura, Johnny, Emmy, Fenn, Butterfly, and all in need, and all those on our prayer lists. O God of grace, hear our prayers. For Pastor Josh on his next call, and I haven't heard how his interview went for his CPE residency, but we pray that it went well and that this is the right next step for him. O God of next steps, hear our prayers. With V, prayers for Nancy, that she would feel the presence of God. We ask God to enfold Nancy in love. Oh, God of love, God who is always with us, hear our prayers. Good. I'm glad that Josh thought it went well, but we'll find out. Right? With Daisy, we pray for a good week. Amen. I can't say it better than that. For Daisy and for all of us, a good week. With Emmy, prayers for Emmy's friend's mother who is struggling to recover from spinal surgery, and for all her friends and all who are all struggling with physical or mental issues. And many, so many are. Oh God of healing and comfort, hear our prayers. With Lily, prays, Lord, help me with selfish thoughts. I can't get them away. That happens to all of us, Lily. And you do a lot for a lot of other people. So God, who helps us keep our focus on heavenly things, hear our prayers. With Joyous, we pray thanksgiving for a beautiful day and blooming flowers. Amen. And for spring, O God of spring and new life, hear our prayers. With V, prayers that V may find a way to do nursing home ministry when all physical doors are shut. Amen. That's such a hard thing for all chaplains, all doing visitation type ministries. We pray for those in the nursing home who are isolated and alone, and for all those who are looking for the best ways to care for them and share God's love. Oh, God of love, hear our prayers. Emmy, prayers that we bring love and peace to those around us. Amen. And light the way in this world for those who are struggling. Amen. Emmy. Oh, God who supports us in sharing God's love, hear our prayers. And yes, Doug, I know that you are in that, in a similar position with that. Lily, prayers that, Lord, that this pandemic can end soon. I think we can all join with an amen on that, Lily. Oh, God of healing, hear our prayers. Did I get all of the spoken prayers? There's another one. Lily, prayers for all those who are falling through the cracks, and there are too many. With the stimulus payments, but how many aren't getting them? Well, there are a lot of people who are falling through the cracks in many ways right now, and we pray for them and know that God is with them. And we pray that they soon get the help that they need. Oh, God, our help, hear our prayers. With Laura, we pray, Lord, please bring security for Laura's son as his place of employment begins furloughs. And if I may, Laura, I'll extend that all to all those who have been laid off or who are facing those kinds of cutbacks and losing their job and their health insurance right at this time. Yes, that God be with them. Lord, our help, God of grace, hear our prayers. Daily prayers for Johnny and all our friends who aren't here today. Yes, for absent friends. We don't know what they need, but God knows, and we pray for that. O God of grace, hear our prayers. I think my chat's a little laggy today. So did I get all of them? All right. Well, if there was a prayer you couldn't get out, you know that we don't need to know what it is. God knows. And we get all our energy behind that too. Lord, hear our prayers. Those voiced here today. Those spoken only in the depths of our hearts. Those for which we have no words. We lift them all to you, trusting in your boundless love and grace. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord is my shepherd, I have all I need. She makes me lie down in green meadows, beside the still waters she will lead. She restores my soul, she rights my wrongs, she leads me in a path of good things, and fills my heart with songs. Even though I said she won't forsake me, I'm in her hand. She sets a table before me in the presence of my foes. She anoints my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely, surely goodness and kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will live
Yes, we can say amen to that as well. So the lectionary gospel reading for this, the fourth Sunday of Easter, which in some churches is recognized as Good Shepherd Sunday, the reading is from the Gospel of John. This passage comes after Jesus heals a blind man by spitting into dirt to make mud and putting it on his eyes. Now, I'll admit that despite the popularity of the imagery of Christ as the Good Shepherd, it has not been one of my favorite images. Maybe because I didn't grow up on a farm or near sheep. It has always felt kind of saccharine sweet to me, nostalgic and irrelevant. And referring to the people of God as sheep, in today's culture, almost insulting, right? Well, not almost. So I thought I would preface today's scripture reading with a little historical cultural information about shepherds and sheep. The nomadic tribes that came before the people of Israel were herders, right? They had herds. And in the early books of the Hebrew Bible, there are a lot of shepherds. Think Abel, as in Cain and Abel. Also Abraham, Isaac, Joseph, Rachel, Moses, and David, to name a few. All shepherds. Sheep were the primary source of food and the raw materials for clothing and shelter. They were important and valued. As society developed monarchies, the shepherd became a model for a good ruler. You know, a ruler who cares for the people, providing them with food and water and protecting them from harm. But as the people of Israel developed a farming economy and then began to live in cities, shepherding lost its cachet. By the time Jesus was born, shepherds were poorly paid and lower class. Devout Jews would not eat with them any more than they would with tax collectors or Gentiles, as they were considered unclean, literally and ritually. So by identifying Jesus as a shepherd, indeed the Good Shepherd, the gospel writers identify Jesus both with the traditional image of a king of Israel and with the poor and marginalized of his time. So let us listen to the Spirit speaking to us through the words of John chapter 10, verses 1 through 10. And then after that, a contemporary reading from the poet David White.
Very truly, I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus uses figure of speech for them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits. But the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be kept safe, and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they might have life and have it abundantly." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
All right. A poem by David White called Sometimes. Sometimes, if you move carefully through a forest, breathing like the ones in the old stories, you could cross a simmering bed of dry leaves without a sound. You come to a place whose only task is to trouble you with tiny but frightening requests, conceived out of nowhere, but in this place beginning to lead everywhere. Request to stop what you're doing right now, to stop what you are becoming while you do it. Questions that can make or unmake a life. Questions that have patiently waited for you. Questions that have no right to go away.
Thank you for those lovely readings. Would you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So today, I'd like to talk about gates. Or doors, if you, as I did, grew up with the King James translation. In this passage, we get one of the seven I am statements by Jesus in the Gospel of John. Jesus says twice, I am the gate. Now, this passage has often been used, like, unfortunately, the other I am sayings, particularly John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life, as exclusionary. Jesus says the way, all caps, the gate, to the exclusion of all others. And I don't think that Jesus meant it that way at all. To explain what I mean, let's play with the image of gate for a bit. So here we have this sheepfold, an area bounded by a fence or a wall, keeping the sheep in together. Isolated, but also safe from wolves and such. And a lot of scholars think that Jesus says, I am the gate, as a reference to how shepherds would sometimes lay over the opening in the wall to block it off. But I read this and it makes no sense to me in this passage, because there is a gatekeeper or a guard in some translations. Jesus doesn't identify himself with the gatekeeper. He's not standing there taking tickets and checking IDs. He is the gate itself, with the shepherd and the shepherd going in and out of the gate, taking care of the sheep. You have to be careful about getting too literal with Jesus' parables. His stories, like the risen Christ himself, is often in two places at once. So what does it mean for Jesus to be the gate? Well, what is a gate, after all, but an opening in the wall or fence? An opening that allows for coming in and going out. Wherever there are walls, fencing people off, locking them out or in, Jesus blows an opening right through them, bringing with him life. I think this is what it means that Jesus is the gate. And apologies in advance for the profanity. It is appropriate in context.
Open the gate.
Go back down the main stairwell.
Open the gate right now.
Go back down the main stairwell like I told you.
God damn it, son of a bitch!
Stop that! Open the damn gate! Come back!
Fabric, Tommy, give me a hand here!
What's that? You can't go up there! You can't go there! Go back to the main stairwell, and everything will be sorted out there.
No, it will.
It will all get sorted out back there. Go back to the main stairwell.
So, yes, that was the Titanic, and the ship was sinking. In the third class, the poorer passengers in the lower decks were locked out from the possibility of getting to the surface and the lifeboats, locked out from life itself. And boom, where once there was a locked fence, there was an open gate, passage to the upper decks, and the possibility for life. And the gatekeeper gets punched in the face in a very satisfying cinematic moment. So what does it mean for Jesus to be the gate? I once heard Celtic Christian scholar John Philip Newell talk about a conversation he had with a rabbi and Hebrew scholar friend about John 14:6. The rabbi said he agreed with the statement, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Why? "Because," said the rabbi, "Jesus was the embodiment of God's love. And no one comes to God except through love." I agree, and I think the same thing applies here. Love is the way, and that love is available to all. Because no walls or fences that might try to separate us from each other can stand against that love. Love is the gate, the door, the portal to life. And not just to survival, like those poor souls on the Titanic, but to, Jesus says, abundant life. Others may try to climb the walls, ignoring the way, the gate of love, for their own selfish reasons, out of greed. They are thieves and bandits. Or, if we read the next several verses of John's Gospel, wolves, bringing destruction and death. Whereas Jesus comes, bringing life, abundant life. What does it mean to have abundant life in these days when we, to be safe, to keep our friends and neighbors safe, need to stay behind walls? What does it mean? What does abundant life mean when the risks and effects of this global pandemic fall disproportionately on some groups? African Americans, the poor, the elderly, and those already with health conditions. You see, I want to note something in this image that Jesus uses. The sheepfold is not a prison. And Jesus doesn't just talk about the sheep going out, but about coming and going, following where he leads. "Whoever enters by me will be kept safe, and will come in and go out and find pasture." Sometimes walls are life-giving because they protect the sheep from danger. There just needs to be a gate and a way to know when to go out and when to stay in. And that way is, you guessed it, love. Follow the love. Love that protects, love that keeps safe and provides green pastures for all who need it. Reverend Jim Keat makes a distinction between economy abundant and life abundant. And we, if we are to follow the love, follow the call of the gospel, We need to find a way to provide everyone with the latter and the former. So now, when we are posting the highest numbers of deaths and rates of infection, who benefits most from opening up our society before the experts say it's safe? Who is trying to climb over the walls meant to protect us or force the sheep out without a shepherd? People should not have to choose between making a living, paying the rent, buying food, and dying from disease. To switch metaphors for a moment, I saw a meme that says, we are not all in the same boat, but we are all in the same storm. We should be able to find a way in love to shore up the leaky boats with very tangible expressions of love in the form of policies and actions that protect those most vulnerable in this pandemic. Like the sheep were to those ancient nomadic tribes, we, each of us, is worthy. Each is just as valuable in the eyes of God, no matter our breed. Churro, Yester, Merino, we are part of the same human flock. But as disciples of Jesus, we are also shepherds. What does abundant life for the whole human flock look like in these times? But even more than that, how can we, following the example of Jesus, be a gate, be a door, so that when the pandemic has passed, we can go out together to new, abundant life? I believe those are, to quote David White, questions that can make or unmake a life, questions that have no right to go away. So we'll keep asking them. And we need to stop what we are doing right now and what we are becoming while we do it. And ask those questions of ourselves, of others, and let love be the answer. Love is the gate. Amen. So during the recent, I mean just this weekend, 24-hour live stream, Call to Unite, Alec Black sang this song.
Everywhere from stepping on up, we don't care. Somebody tell me what we gonna do. Even though it's plenty to share, people hungry in the streets, it ain't fair. But you don't think about it until it's you. Now I'm gonna say how I feel, and what I want to say is love, the only thing that's real. Right, nobody wins in a fight, but still we
So for Holy Communion this morning, we sanctify our time, our table, and many tables that are really one table spanning the whole world. We celebrate a sacrament never confined to sanctuaries or precious surfaces carved with "do this in remembrance of me," but always, always following wherever one of God's precious children is. Christ is our shepherd. In the loneliest lockdown, we do not want for companionship in crowded families, distance learning, and never catching breath. We find an inner source of still waters. In soul-stretching days of healthcare and emergency professionals, decision-making for others, and essential workers with daily risk, we meet a restorer of souls. In the paths of righteousness, assisted living, correctional facilities, shelter, immigration detention, nursing homes, housing for those who are simply poor, we find a leader, a staff to lean on, a rod that points a new way. Christ leads us not around it, but through the valley of the shadow, and turns to us as Jesus did when he came through the walls of a locked room in the afternoon of resurrection and said, "Peace be with you." And then asked if they had anything to eat, to give him to eat. Give the gentle shepherd who is the risen Christ your bread, your cup, and your heart. I invite you to hold your hands over the elements as we pray. Gentle host, you prepare a table before us as in the threatening presence of virus. You anoint our hearts, bless our bread, and our cups overflow. Surely, as we shelter in place, we find both the goodness of community and mercy to those most vulnerable. Now and all the days of our lives, we claim that this house, these many houses where we dwell, and this space in which we connect to each other and you are indeed the house of God. Send your spirit of life and love, power and blessing upon your children who are staying at home so that this bread may be broken and gathered in love, and this cup poured out to give hope to all. Risen Christ, live in us that we may live in you. Breathe in us that we may breathe in you. Amen. Now I invite you to hold the elements that you have gathered where you are, the bread or cookie or cracker and something to drink. Feel their weight as we remember the sharing of bread in many places. Wilderness manna, tents and caves of shepherds, Abigail's saddlebags, the lunch of a small boy, the fish of the disciples and the loaf of Emmaus. And we remember that Paul, the apostle, wrote letters to congregations throughout places we now call Greece, Turkey, Macedonia, including these communion words sent to the church at Corinth. "For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, and as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Now let us share the bread of heaven and the cup of blessings together, and know that we are one in this bread and cup we share. Let us pray. Lord, we give thanks for this meal of grace and rejoice that the risen Christ's love is not limited by buildings made with human hands, nor contained in human ceremonies. And celebrating the God's shepherding that carries us into the unknown, to listen and follow, to lead and be led, to feed and be fed. Amen. Amen. Our worship is over. Our ministry to the world is just beginning. Go in peace. Come again in hope. And amen.
I'm not afraid to other side of the rain.